A Shortcut Through Vipassana Meditation by Prabhutadasa Bhikkhu. A Shortcut Through Vipassana Meditation for All People. Sathuchon and Faithful Inquirers of Buddhism. This is the fourth Saturday lecture session in commemoration of the Makabucha season. I will speak on the subject of Samatha Vipassana meditation. This is actually the third lecture since I skipped one last Saturday. So even though this is the fourth Saturday, my lecture today will count as the third in the series of Samatha Vipassana meditation of the nuclear age. Concerning the title, the title Samatha Vipassana Meditation of the Nuclear Age may sound a bit unusual. Nevertheless, I would like you to have a proper understanding of it. First of all, I would like it to convey the idea that we are in the age of science. Therefore, I intend to carry on my explanation in scientific inauguration. At the same time, since the nuclear age is that in which we are doing things in serious earnesty, this explanation is going to be no trifling a matter. Neither is it meant to be a hazy kind of presentation. Insofar as the scientific process is concerned, one starts out with a concrete object. One studies it, researching, testing, and making experiments. Now, since the object of Samatha Vipassana is the citta, the heart and the mind, which is neither material nor concrete, how are we to deal with it? How are we to make it concrete enough so that we can study, analyze, test, and make experiments with it? I would like you to try your best to concretize the matter, otherwise you might not understand, and this lecture would become useless. If you are following it without any real purpose, you might end up just memorizing the words without profiting anything from it. You must look at the subject as a perfect reality of which you need to really get a deep understanding, that is, within your feeling. Think of the word santittiko, which means to feel in the heart. What we are discussing today, we must feel it in the heart, even though it is abstract in nature. That is, without shape and physical body, it is as if it has shape and physical body, since it can be witnessed in the heart. So just feel the feeling, whether it be happiness or suffering. Then it will become real, concrete enough for you to study and analyze in accordance with the scientific process. I beg you to share your understanding with me at this point, or else you will not profit from what I am saying. Please keep in mind the words, the nuclear age. You should listen with a conviction that you belong to the nuclear age. You must really delve down into the matter. This is not the time to memorize, to make conjectures, or to take flights in imagination. So let's get a proper understanding once more of the reasons why I use the title Samatha Vipassana Meditation of the Nuclear Age for this particular series of lectures. Merits of the practice of Samatha Vipassana. Now let me repeat again that which needs to be repeated. You must continuously feel it in the heart. Don't you become bored. It is the truest truth that Samatha Vipassana Meditation, the topic we are discussing, is the subject we need to adopt or to practice with earnesty. It's not for mere knowledge and memorization of the methodology. It is for you to practice. For what purpose? Yes, so that you can solve the problems that truly exist. The first truth is that we shall suffer whenever we exercise not enough mindfulness, sati, and intellect, panya, at the time a contact occurs. Now, those of you who just come today may not understand. Nevertheless, please try to remember that sufferings arise and become a constant inflictor because we are ignorant at the time we have contacts. Our daily contacts through our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, touch, and heart. At the time of contact, we are ignorant. It is as if we know nothing. This means we have no mindfulness, no feeling, no intellect to understand things thoroughly. So the heart flirts with all kinds of ideas which eventually end up in suffering. This is another topic which needs a long explanation. Actually, I once gave you a talk on this. Those who have not heard should try to understand that suffering is the result of our ignorance at the point of contact with the various things in our daily life. If you don't want to be ignorant, you must have enough mindfulness. The response of your mindfulness must be quick enough or in time for a contact. Then you must acquire the insight and the knowledge along the line of vipassana, so that you will be able to understand the nature of things. Just the right amount of knowledge. Mindfulness will transport this kind of knowledge right at the time of contact. Whenever one has both mindfulness and the right kind of knowledge at the time of contact, the heart will not get carried away with ideas in ignorance and suffering. The two principles will control the heart and guide it along the path of thoughts and reasonings which will lead not to suffering. Anything that needs to be corrected or resolved will, of course, rightly be done. There won't be a misdeed. Thus, good consequence is to be expected. One will not be unhappy either. This is the significance of mindfulness at the time of contact. One special merit is that we need have no sufferings. Now, another merit is that we will be able to control the heart. If we have the kind of mindfulness and intellect along the line of vipassana, we will be able to control the heart. How to keep the heart under control is a broad topic, its merits being efficient for all purposes. Only if we are able to control the heart, we will be successful in every undertaking. We will meet with nothing undesirable. There are two points here, you see. If we are able to control our heart, there won't be permitted any undesirable flip of thoughts. If we have control over the heart, we can, of course, conduct it in the way it should be. Therefore, we will have no cause for suffering. The Lord Buddha spoke of more merits, but I think two are sufficient here. That is, we must have mindfulness at the time of contact. If we are not ignorant at the time of contact, we won't suffer. And if we are able to control our heart, we won't let it wander along the path of sufferings. We won't have any cause for worries or for what is called hangover feelings. Those who keep on worrying days and nights might turn out to be neurotic. There are more and more people suffering from neurosis these days. Even though I stay here in one place, I know that more and more people are suffering from neurosis. I know it because more of the neurotic people come here. This is the age in which everything is so unsettled, hard to control. More people turn neurotic. So, let me give you this. Vipassana meditation can very well prevent you from neurosis. The reason is that if we can control the heart, we will be able to shake off any undesirable feeling and thought. To sum up, we practice samatha vipassana in order to quicken our awareness and to gain control over the heart. These two merits are more than enough, since all problems have to do with them. If we have enough of an awareness and a good control of the heart, we will take care of all problems here. We will solve all problems here. The heart in control will be the basis of enlightenment, the attainment of Nibbana and Arahat. Therefore, our aim is to quicken our response and to gain control over the heart. All right, there are just these two points: to acquire mindfulness and to control the heart. Take notice of the time when mindfulness is in control of the heart. Now, you should take notice that the practice of vipassana or samatha vipassana, as I shall be explaining presently, is the method both for engendering mindfulness and for controlling the heart. You should be attentive to the explanation. Look for the specific item which tells you exactly how to conduce to mindfulness. Keep watch for it. I will go on to explain it step by step until I come to a completion. Now, let's discuss some points which need to be taken care of at the moment. First, I must tell you that the whole system of samatha vipassana, as existing in the Pali scriptures, is indeed thorough and extensive. Therefore, there is a lot of details on what to do. The Lord Buddha gave the most complete explanation, all-inclusive, for those who have a serious intention, say, to leave home and to take an abode in the forest. They are the ones who devote all of their time and energy to the practice. Therefore, the Lord Buddha made a great many minute explanations, indeed a perfect exposure, a deep exposure of the methodology. Now, for those who are not leaving their homes for the forests, who are not going to follow that kind of perfect life, what are they to do? Well, of course, there was this type of people in those days when the Lord Buddha was still preaching. Yes, there were many who did not leave their homes and did not take their dwellings in the forests. Those who were not monks who would practice day or night. There were people who could not do all that, of course. Therefore, there had to be also a shortcut system or a summary for those who might not follow the whole methodology. They could attain the ultimate end too. This shortcut system or the summary is another system for those who do not wish to follow the complete pattern. Just think of the time when the Lord Buddha was still preaching. Which group had more members? The largest group, of course, consisted of the common folk. There were not as many who stayed in the forests and seriously practiced meditation. Therefore, there had to be a system for teaching the ordinary people. So there were two systems of samatha vipassana. One the most perfect and extensive, which I will explain to you some other time. And another, the system for the ordinary people who made up a larger portion of the population. Besides, you may look at it the other way. Are there more of the ignorant or more of the intelligent? Well, of course, there are more of the ordinary and some of the ignorant, who are hard at understanding things. Maybe more so of this kind. Now, we are going to try to get down to explain the methodology so that even those who are ordinary or ignorant can learn and practice too. I intend to speak in plain terms for the ordinary people. These ordinary people, who are untrained, uneducated, should acquire knowledge enough to kindle their understanding. They should train themselves so as to bring about their own salvation. To sum up, if we talk only about the formal system with all its details, elaboration, and most complete expository remarks, we might end up barren, because there is only a small number of people who are intellectually equipped to understand it. Therefore, there must be another system that is just right for the ordinary people. For the time being, I shall call it a shortcut system. Don't you feel anxious that you would not be able to arrive at the ultimate end through this shortcut? I wish you to realize that this shortcut system can very well lead you to an extinction of suffering. Why is it a shortcut? Well, it's because you don't have to go through the whole formal system. There are certain facets which you need not go through, especially those supernatural psychic exercises or even those psychic absorptions of the sphere of form or of the formless sphere, rupa and arupa jhana. You need to work towards an attainment of those two types of absorptions in this shortcut system. What you need is to attain one pointedness of mind, samadhi, to a certain degree. Then you may go on straight away to contemplate the highest truth pertaining to the law of impermanence, suffering, and selflessness. This is so that you can eventually put an end to your suffering. Now, any of those who are able to attain the state of absorption may go ahead to develop either the rupa or arupa jhana. Then after that, they may turn to the contemplation of impermanence, suffering, and selflessness. They may excel in their undertakings, having the various supernatural powers plus insights. That's very good indeed. That's superb. Too much so. That's not for the practical ordinary people. So I am not going to talk about it yet. I am not going to talk about the great system today. I will explain only about the shortcut system in so far as it will be profitable for the ordinary people. Now, don't you presume that a shortcut won't be able to serve the ultimate end? It will be efficient enough. That is, it will lead you to your expected goal too. But you won't be an expert. Let's put it that way. You'll also come to the goal, but you won't be an expert. Yet it's sufficient for our purpose here. Otherwise, you might die for nothing. As for those who are not so proficient, don't expect too much, or you'll die for nothing. Just be contented with the fact that eventually you'll be able to put an end to your suffering. Therefore, I will bring out only few points in such a way that they will serve a shortcut system. A shortcut system. If you ask what a shortcut system is, I answer that it is a system which leaves out that which is lengthy or unnecessary. This is it, a shortcut. Think of our house. If we have just the necessary, just barely enough to eat, to live, and to use, this is enough for us to live on. But we usually have too many things unnecessary for our life. Our house is full of unnecessary belongings, and we owners are like madmen. Indeed, this kind of house is like a madman's house. There are unnecessary articles, too many, you see. Now, If you throw away all of the unnecessary and keep only what is necessary, you live only on the necessary. We'll not die. We can survive and be happy. There won't be as much confusion as when you live in a house too full of unnecessary stuff. But today, people tend to be carried away with new fads and fashion. They buy everything that is advertised. They put them all in the house, so the house becomes easily messed up. This is unnecessary, you know. Now, the same is true with the way to go about practicing meditation. Our principle is, we'll leave out the unnecessary, we'll leave it out. We will tread on the necessary steps. So this is a shortcut. So if you ask, what is a shortcut? The answer is, we'll leave out what is unnecessary. It is not a full formal exposition. Nothing elaborate, aesthetic, complicated, or mystical. I speak only of what is necessary for an extinction of suffering. Now, if you ask, why a shortcut? Why a shortcut? As I have said, I don't want you to waste time. I don't want you to meet with a failure. If there be no shortcut, and there be only the great system, which is just for the proficient, the not-so-proficient won't be able to follow, and the practice would be of limited use, because there is only a small number of people who can follow it. This is why we need a shortcut for the ordinary people, or for a majority of people. A comparison between the shortcut system and the great system. Now, let's make a comparison and see how we go through a shortcut. In talking about the great system, we have to start with the breathing exercise in accordance with the four foundations of mindfulness. For this, you might consult the Anapanasati Sutra. I'll make a comparison between the great system and the shortcut system. According to the great system, there are those four foundations of mindfulness: the body, the feeling, the heart and the mind, and Dhamma, nature. For the body, we are concerned with breathing. This means we choose to be mindful of our breathing. If the breathing in is short, just know that it is short. If the breathing out is long, just know that it is long. Then you may go on to meditate until you come to the realization that it is the breathing that dresses up the body. Then you may go on to manipulate the breathing in such a way that it becomes quiet and your mind stops wandering. Then you may come to the various stages of absorption or jhana, say, the absorption in the formless sphere, and so on. To progress along the four steps pertaining to the four foundations of mindfulness mentioned is actually a painstaking job. But if we use the shortcut system, we need not go into as much detailed a prescription and practice. What we need is to have a certain amount of one-pointedness. Then we can go on to meditate on the physical makeup, say, the breathing. To concentrate on just one of the four foundations is a big enough undertaking. However, to aim at attaining absorption, we will have to devote much time and effort. As a matter of fact, we'll have to work up to the level of Appana Chan. Through Chana, we are to experience joy and happiness and so on. But we don't have to go through all that in the shortcut system. Now, we come to the second section, the feeling. Here we may choose to meditate on the feeling of joy that actually arises in our heart. This joyful feeling is derived from absorption. Or you may choose to meditate on the happy feeling, which actually exists in your heart. You study its nature by watching it, so that you come to the realization that it's this that dresses up the heart. After that, you search for the way to calm down the joy and the happiness until you succeed. To tread along these four steps is painstaking enough. The ordinary people won't be able to go through all of them, that is, to study the joy and the happiness in such a disinterested manner so as to calm them down. So the shortcut system offers you a bypass. That is, after the heart attains one-pointedness to a certain degree, you may meditate on whatever feeling that arises. This is not the same as the feeling derived from the state of absorption. So, whatever you feel, whether it be pleasure or displeasure, you will try to control it as much as you can. Then you'll eventually realize by yourself that the feeling is an illusion. Feeling is just illusion. This is an easy way to meditate. Just one step for you to deal with. But its final outcome is equal to the four steps in the section of mindfulness of feeling. Now, we come to the third section of the great system, mindfulness of the heart. In mindfulness, we will know how to the heart is, how to make the heart joyful, how to make the heart one-pointed, and how to make the heart let go of things. It is difficult, as if to make you practice the Chinese acrobatics. If you follow the shortcut system, you don't have to go through the four steps. These four steps are as follows. First, you contemplate the heart. Contemplate every expression of the heart, so that you understand it well. Then you should be able to cheer up your heart in an instant, to make it one-pointed in an instant. You must be clever and skillful enough to do all these. So, if these are too much for you, all right, leave them. We may now leap to the fourth section, mindfulness of Dhamma. That is, after you have attained one-pointedness to a certain degree as a result of contemplation of the body in the first section, you may go ahead to contemplate impermanence. Every phase of the feeling, the breathing, or whatever object of contemplation is impermanent. You are to realize this impermanence. So, this is a leaping from the first section of contemplation to the fourth section. You may witness the state of impermanence straight away. You may see impermanence of the physical body, of this life. So you continue to contemplate impermanence. Whether you are breathing in or breathing out, you should do this until you feel a release from love and pleasure, from everything that you used to hold on to, such as happiness or even your life, with which you used to fall in love and to which you become attached. You become less attached. This is because you see its impermanent nature. You, of course, loosen your cling to life. You are beginning to feel free. Free. Contemplate particularly this feeling. You'll see impermanence. Once you see that you are loosening your attachment, you are to contemplate this feeling of loosening until you come to the point of dissolution of some of your attachment. Then you may contemplate the state of dissolution of attachment. You may even contemplate that which has fallen from your attachment, that which has gone away, that which has been shaken off. This is the fourth step in the fourth section, to shake off attachment. Actually, you don't need to contemplate that which has been let go, because once you have let it go, you'll come to the end of suffering. You are able to extinguish suffering, all right. This is the point of satisfaction. You don't need to watch it any further. Therefore, what you should do is to contemplate impermanence. Watch the process of loosening and the point of dissolution. This is enough. But the whole methodology requires that you contemplate that which has been shaken off too. You have shaken off such and such, you have won, and so on. We can save a lot by using the shortcut. By this way, we practice mindfulness until we attain a certain degree of one-pointedness. We may be mindful of the breathing or of anything that you have with you. After that, you take notice of every kind of feeling that happens to arise. You contemplate the impermanent aspect of it. Of course, you can deal with it in detail, some of which I'll explain to you later. But the quickest shortcut is you contemplate every single thing that arises in your feeling. Once you have seen impermanence, you are at good advantage. This is what the folk might say, victory is on your side. You are at good advantage if you see impermanence of things. You keep watch of that impermanence as long as possible until you feel relieved, relieved of attachment automatically. The natural law is that the feeling will relieve itself. And again, by the natural law, that which has been relieved may eventually dissolve. One case after another. Nothing complicated, nothing ritualistic, nothing long involved. We can say that once you have seen impermanence, you can shake off attachment. Attachment falls away as leaves fall in autumn. This is all. So, attain considerable one-pointedness of mind, contemplate impermanence, experience the feeling of loss and dissolution, just like falling leaves in autumn. This is a short way, you see. However, if you want the complete methodology, you have to go through the four fundamentals of mindfulness, with the four steps for each fundamental. So there will be 16 steps in all. This is a long story. 1 month won't be enough to complete it. If one writes a book, it will be quite a big book. So we are not going to talk about the complete methodology of the great system. Today I speak of the shortcut system, the shortcut method, which is right for everyone. So listen carefully. Forget about the comparison which I have just made. You might have got confused already, so no need to make comparisons. What I want you to see is only that you are not going to lose anything by the shortcut. I am not going to speak any more of the reasons why we use the shortcut. Now we are going to talk of the way, of what we are going to do in this so-called shortcut. The breathing exercise in the shortcut system. I'll divide the subject matter into two sections, otherwise it might be too long. Two sections will make it easier to understand. The first section deals with the breathing exercise. The second section deals with the body posture and movement. First, let me speak of the breathing exercise, so that it will be the basis of your understanding. It is the ABC of the other systems which you might encounter in the future. So let me speak of the breathing. Now we contemplate our breathing. Actually, we all have to breathe. What we need now is to be aware of it, be mindful, or make the heart attend to our breathing. Or, I may say, be mindful. Make the sati attend to your breathing. Watch the breathing in and the breathing out. You may or may not close your eyes, up to your convenience, but be mindful of the breathing in, out, in, out. Watching your own breathing will give you a strange feeling, not similar to the time when you are not watching it. Usually, your mind wanders to a number of different things, such as the cattle, farms, fields, and various sensuous objects. Your mind wanders. Your heart goes for everything that lures, and it hooks your heart up like a bait. Now, make it mindful of the breathing in and out. In and out. You see, this is the way to develop mindfulness. Here, mindfulness is being developed. If you succeed, you have mindfulness. You should know that you are directly managing mindfulness. Put the sati, or mindfulness, in the position to contemplate breathing. You learn to contemplate more and more thoroughly and deeply. At first, you just know that it is breathing in and out. All right, you don't need to say it out loud. You say it in your heart, in and out. No need to make noise, otherwise it might disturb. When you breathe in, say, in, ya. When you breathe out, say, out, ya. Or you might just say, in or out, without the ya. But this ya is useful. I'll explain it to you later. This is not a small matter, you know, for the heart won't be that obedient. It will wriggle. It will refuse to be in one place. It wishes to wander. So whoever succeeds in contemplating the in and out aspect of the breathing can say that his mindfulness has been heavily trained, or his heart has been put under severe discipline. You must train yourself so that you become mindful of a particular sense object, in this case, the breathing. Control the mindfulness and take care not to let it wander about. I would like to give you a hint here. You should be observing this in a relaxing manner. It will come out better than being tense and serious, because that involves attachment. So just relax and observe the breathing. In, out, in, out, in, out. Take a reasonable length of time to observe this. Once you have mastered this, whenever it will be, you may move to the next step. This time observe more thoroughly as to whether the breathing is short or long. If the breathing in is short, know just that it is short. If the breathing out is long, know just that it is long. You might also say to yourself, short ya, or long ya, as you wish. So at this point, your mindfulness will be trained to observe the duration of the breathing, short or long as it may be. For the first step, you say to yourself, in ya, out ya. For the second step, you say, short ya, or long ya, or long ya, or short ya. So you are being trained to watch either the short or the long duration of the breathing. Now, the next step further is for you to observe whether the breathing is coarse or fine. If your breathing is heavy, it is coarse. If it is light, it is fine. If your heart or your emotion is being excited, your breathing will be coarse. Suppose you are angry or frightened, your breathing will be coarse. If there is no such incident, your breathing will be fine. It will be fine. When you observe that it is coarse, you will eventually acknowledge that it is coarse, yeah? And if it is fine, you will of course acknowledge that it is fine, yeah? Here you need not be worried anymore as to when it goes in or out, short or long, because they are within you already. So if you know that it is coarse, it means you also know that it is coarse going out or coarse coming in. In being mindful of the coarse or the fine movement of the breathing, you will know at the same time that this is the breathing in or the breathing out movement. You see, in getting to know the breathing, you don't need to be a scholar of any kind. A farmer can do it. What you need to do is to sit down at the right place. Yes, sit down, relax at the right place. Don't be too picky about the place. Any place in which you can relax will do. You sit cross-legged and relax. You sit in such a way that you won't tumble down. Yes, make it easy. Just sit like a child who is trying to sit cross-legged for the first time. This is good enough. To sum up, first, you start out by being mindful of the breathing in and the breathing out. Then you turn to be mindful of the short or long duration of the breathing. Then you turn to be mindful of the coarse or fine movement of the breathing. This is not difficult. Not difficult. If you can't do this, you'll be good for nothing. You won't be any different from a cat, right? If you can't do this, you will be like a cat. Why? Because this is the shortest way, the lowest, the easiest. Get to know the physical and mental assets through your contemplation. Now, this time, you move up the ladder to the next step in the practice. Even though this is a shortcut system, it consists also of the state of refinement, depth, and advancement. At first, you learn to be mindful of breathing. Breathing is the object of your mindfulness. Breathing is the physical asset that is the object of your mindfulness. However, the part that is being mindful is the citta. The citta is the mental asset. Now, this time let us be mindful of the functions of the citta. You are going to be mindful of the mental activities. When you are mindful of the mental activities, you may say to yourself, nama, yeah? On the contrary, if you are mindful of the physical activities, you may say, rupa, yeah? For example, as you are being mindful of the breathing, you say to yourself, rupa, yeah? As you are being mindful of the feeling, you say, nama, yeah? Now, you understand what I mean by rupa and nama. in being mindful of the short or long duration of the breathing, or of the coarse or fine movement of the breathing, you are concerned with the physical aspect. This sort of physical aspect is called upatthaya rupa. It refers to the various characteristics of the breathing. However, if you refer to the breath itself, the breath is called Mahabhuta Rupa. We may be mindful just of the Mahabhuta Rupa. Well, no need to go further into this. It's not necessary. So just be clear to yourself that in being mindful of the breathing, you are concerned with the physical asset. On the contrary, if you are mindful of the feeling, you are concerned with the mental asset. If I use Pali terms for everything, you might find them too difficult to remember, and that would be too much for a shortcut system. We might be wasting too much time. So just be mindful of the mental and the physical assets within yourself. Anything that is material or that is related to it is rupa. Anything that is abstract is nama or citta. You now have to learn to be aware of the nature of the object of your mindfulness. If the sense object is of material nature, say rupaya. If the object is the feeling, say namaya. Get to know the five aggregates through your contemplation. This time, let's contemplate a bit further. Are you getting sleepy? Some of you might get irritated already. It's natural if you don't understand. Now, we are going to contemplate a bit further so that you'll become a little more clever. This time, I would like you to know the so-called five aggregates. The five aggregates are the physical asset, rupa, the feeling, vedana, the perception or recollection, sanya, the volition or thought, sankhara, and the consciousness, vijnana. I will explain their functions to you. I have explained to you already that you should be mindful of your breathing, in, out, short, long, and coarse, fine. Then I have talked about the physical asset and the mental asset. The breathing constitutes the rupa, or the physical asset. At the time you are watching your breathing, you may encounter a certain feeling. You may feel comfortable, happy, pleased. Sometimes you feel sore and aching. This sort of feeling constitutes the vedana, or the feeling aggregate. When you are mindful of a feeling, you may say to yourself, vedana ya. Now, you have to know what a vedana is by actual experience. It should not be a word which you just learn to repeat or memorize. At the time you are watching your breathing, you are to recognize whether it is long or short. You are to recognize whether it is coarse or fine, and so on. The ability to recognize what it is called sanya. This is the perception or the recollection aggregate. Now, if you are able to be mindful of a perception, you may say sanya, ya. This sanya is another mental aggregate you should learn to keep watch. In so doing, you say sanya, ya. In being mindful, you might notice that there is a seed of thought lurking. This seed of thought and the thought are sankhara. The sankhara cooks up thoughts. So when you are being mindful of a thought, you say, sankhara, yeah. This time, let's be mindful of the vijnana. Whenever you are mindful of the breathing, your consciousness or vijnana responds to the body, the skin, and the nose, for example. This physical consciousness is called Gaya Vijnana. If you are aware of the mental consciousness, your awareness responds to the knowing citta, which is called Mano Vijnana. You see, we have gone through the discussion of mindfulness of the five aggregates, namely the rupa, the vetana, the sanya, the sankhara, and the vijnana. You are to contemplate each of these aggregates as it rises in your consciousness. You must get to know it in your actual experience. This is what is called santittiko. To be mindful of the mental and physical aggregates is to be mindful of the physical body, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. Both the upadaya rupa and the mahabhuta rupa constitute the physical asset. The feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness constitute the mental asset. In other words, the mental asset is made up of four aggregates. If you are willing to put some time and effort, you can certainly remember these terms. It's not difficult. Just try. It might take you a day or so to memorize, and then you may begin to contemplate the physical aggregate, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness, each one at a time. Even if you begin with the breathing exercise, you may encounter risings of the feeling, of the perception or recollection, of the volition or thought, and of the consciousness, each of which you may learn to contemplate. Remember that when you watch your breathing, you may encounter all of these five aggregates, namely the physical, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. To cut it short, you might say you are being mindful of the physical and mental aggregates. Or to spell it out, you might say you are being mindful of the physical, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. Very good for those who have been taking notes, because you may remember. As for those who do not take notes, you might not be able to remember much. I think it might take time for you to learn. Learn to contemplate risings and fallings. After you have contemplated the physical and mental aggregates, you may go on to contemplate risings and fallings. For the following section, I will talk about contemplation of risings and fallings. In the breathing exercise, we can observe the rising of a breathing, and the rising of a long breathing, the rising of a short breathing, the rising of a coarse breathing, and the rising of a fine breathing. These characteristics are called upadaya rupa. It rises every now and then, you see. Now that a breathing in is finished, we say the breathing falls. At the same time, we may say that a long breathing or a short breathing or a coarse breathing or a fine breathing falls. This means when we are mindful of the physical and mental aggregates, whether it be the body, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, or the consciousness, we may certainly observe its rising and falling conditions. When a breathing rises and falls, it means a rupa rises and falls. When a feeling rises, it means a vedana rises. And when a feeling falls, it means a vedana falls. Then a perception or a recollection can also rise and fall. A thought or a sankhara can also rise and fall. When a consciousness is at work, we may say that a vijnana rises. However, when it stops functioning, it falls. Now let's make an analysis of the rising and falling conditions. To see how things function or rise, and to see how they cease to function or fall. You don't need to verbalize each time you see a rising or a falling. Well, you may do so if you are quick enough, but usually in the beginning, you won't be that responsive. So this is not something you can master right away. It may take you days and weeks before you can be mindful of what you are doing, before you can verbalize exactly each moment of rising and falling. Rise, ya, fall, ya. These conditions may happen to the body, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volitional thought, or the consciousness. Each time you say those words, you must realize its actual rising and falling within your perception. You must realize that such and such feeling rises before you say, rise, ya. This is not a matter of recitation from memory. If you are watching your breathing, you must actually realize you are breathing in when you tell yourself, rise, ya. Now, if you are experiencing the long or short duration of the breathing, you may say, long, ya, or short, ya, whatever it may be. You are acknowledging what is actually happening. This is not an anticipation or a conjecture. Therefore, we are being scientific here, because we are dealing with reality. This is not philosophizing, talking over much by using logical calculations. So when you notice the rising or the falling of your breathing, you don't need to say, the body aggregate rises, yeah. It's too long, you see. You might find it out of beat with the breathing rhythm. The same is true with the other four aggregates, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. So all you need to say is, rise, yeah, or fall, yeah. The important thing is, you must actually feel the rising and the falling. Contemplation of impermanence. Now we may move up another step. Let's move to the next step further to contemplate impermanence. After you have been skilled in witnessing rising and falling conditions, you'll eventually come to a realization by yourself that things are not at all permanent. How can they be permanent when they have to go through the process of risings and fallings all the time? This is what happens to the breathing. Rising witnesses the following phases, the beginning, the middle, and the end. It is not permanent. The same is true with both the short and the long durations. They are not permanent. They change, whether or not you are watching them. The same is also true with the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. They are not constant. They change. And so they are liable to become extinct. They come into being, they change, and they disappear. So contemplate the point at which it manifests impermanence and change. You may utter, oh, change, ya, change, ya. impermanence, yeah? Impermanence, yeah? You may utter these words each time you feel the state of impermanence. Remember, you must feel it within your heart. Then you may utter impermanence, yeah? Yes, you may do so each time you see impermanence of the form, the breathing, the body, the short or long duration of the breathing, the coarse or fine movement of the breathing, the feeling in connection with the breathing, the perception in connection with the breathing, and the volition or thought in connection with the breathing. You should contemplate the true nature of yourself. You should not just blurting out words. You should say to yourself, impermanence, only if you are truly experiencing the state of impermanence, whether it be in the breathing, in the feeling, in the perception or recollection, in the volition or thought, or in the consciousness. Once you have witnessed their impermanent nature, you may realize that the five aggregates are truly impermanent. You will realize this truth deep down in the very depth of your heart. You will see impermanence like this. Impermanence, yeah? Impermanence, yeah? This is the part on contemplation of impermanence. Contemplation of selflessness. After this, we may move another step further to contemplate anatta or selflessness. You'll see just the breathing in, the breathing out. There is no self there, no owner of the breath, no owner of life. There are just the risings and fallings of breathing, just the coarse or fine movement of the breathing, just the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. There is no person. There is no person who is doing such and such. There is only the rhythmic motion of nature. To feel selflessness here means to feel selflessness in the breathing, selflessness in the characteristics of the breathing, selflessness in the citta that is contemplating the breathing, selflessness in the manifestations of the physical body, the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. Here you don't see a person, a creature, or a man. When you actually feel this state of truth, you may utter to yourself, anatta, yeah? No self, yeah? Or you may say, just the breathing, yeah? Just the form, yeah? Just the feeling, yeah? There is no self. This ya response signifies that you are getting clever. You know there is no such thing as the self. I will talk about the ya later. Now let's talk only of the contemplation of selflessness. There are only the breathing, the body, the heart. There are the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. Selfless, yeah, or anatta, yeah. If you see selflessness while contemplating breathing, you may say, the breathing is not the self, yeah. If you are watching the heart that is contemplating the breathing, you may say, the feeling is not the self, yeah. The breathing is just the breathing, not the self. This is enough. You should just breathe in or out. If it is short, it is simply short. If it is long, it is simply long. They are not the self. This is the contemplation of selflessness, the so-called anattanupatsi. It is not expounded in the Anapanasati Sutra, but it is inclusive in the section on impermanence. Therefore, the Buddha uses such terms as anicca-nupatsi, viraga-nupatsi, nirodha-nupatsi, and patinissaka-nupatsi. But there is no mentioning of anatta-nupatsi as such, since it is inclusive in the discussion on impermanence already. The point is, if one sees impermanence, one eventually sees selflessness. But, as I would like you ordinary people to see things in full scale, I have to expound the part on selflessness separately. When we observe breathing, we shall see that breathing is selfless. The short or long duration of breathing, the coarse or fine movement of breathing are also selfless. This is because it does not remain the same. The feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness are also selfless. So, whenever you see selflessness, you may utter selfless ya. You may contemplate the nature of selflessness as long as you wish. You see, this section is meant for you to contemplate selflessness. Selfless, yeah? If you truly see selflessness, you'll automatically turn mellow. You'll become bored, that is, become less intoxicated by things you used to love and feel possessive. You'll become less attached to happiness, delight, and things of delicious attraction. You'll even become less attached to life. This diminution of attachment is called viraga, viraga-nupasi. This means our heart is beginning to relax or relieve itself of what we used to be crazy or in love or possess. Now, relax, yeah? Relax, yeah? We have been relieved, relieved, yeah? Relieved, yeah? Relieved, yeah? Relieved, yeah? If the feeling continue to experience relief deeper and deeper, it will automatically reveal that there is something that has been extinguished. Oh, extinguished, yeah? Extinguished, yeah? Gone, yeah? Nirodha nupatsi. Well, I don't mean that you have to utter the Pali word, for it might be too much of a trouble for you. You see that things are impermanent and selfless, so you feel relieved. The heart is relieved. Thus extinguished are the feelings of love and infatuation. Extinguished, yeah? Extinguished is the misconception that this is ourself or that belongs to ourself. Extinguished are some things and some parts in, say, the breathing, the feeling, the perception. You may stop here. When things are extinguished in our feeling, this is enough. But if you don't want to stop, you may move on to the next step in the practice, to throw back. Patinissaka. Now I have thrown back that to which I used to feel attached. We have thrown back that to which we used to feel attached. This means our attachment has been extinguished. That to which we used to feel attached is extinguished, gone, disappeared. This is what is meant by throwing back. You don't need to come to this, but if you wish, it's all right. So, what you used to consider lovable, pleasing, impressive, one way or another, now you can say you have thrown away. Away, yeah? Patinissakkanupatsi. In this way, you come to the final goal too. Even though this is the shortcut system for the ordinary people, it will eventually end up at the point of fade out, relief, and total abandonment. In practicing the four foundations of mindfulness, you may go through the four steps in each foundation, or you may move concurrently from one foundation to the other. Once you see impermanence, you might fade out your feeling of attachment, and then throw away that to which you used to feel attached. I believe that in the Buddha's lifetime, there was no minute explanation like this. The point is, once one trains one's heart to a certain degree, the heart will experience a relief. It will abandon things it used to take hold of. The feeling of attachment will extinguish without having to go through all those steps, with names difficult enough to remember. Therefore, when one sees impermanence in the various things repeatedly so, one will see selflessness. Then the heart will relieve itself, will put things down, and then it abandons them. These many steps may be summed up under one word, liberation. When one sees impermanence in full view, one should focus on it with utmost one-pointedness. It is like focusing on it with light. Things will fall away as leaves falling off a tree. Whatever attachment will, of course, fall away. The teacher sometimes used just one word, liberation. This one word is enough. But let's understand that this one word includes an ability to see impermanence, selflessness, fading out, boredom, extinction, abandonment, and throwing back. One will be able to see all these at the same time. Review the lesson on breathing. Contemplation of breathing can lead you all the way to the goal. This I hope you don't forget. I told you that I would speak first on breathing. I have not talked about the various body movements yet. A lot more is still left unexplained. Now I'm speaking of the breathing. You are supposed to be mindful of breathing. Breathing in, breathing out. Breathing in, breathing out. Short, ya, long, ya. Short, ya, long, ya. Coarse, ya, fine, ya. Coarse, ya. Fine, ya. The body, ya. The mental, ya. The feeling, ya. The perception, ya. You contemplate that which you actually feel while you are breathing. So the sense objects are connected with the breathing. Then you contemplate the risings and the fallings of the breathing, and whatever that is connected with the breathing. The mental aggregates are four: the feeling, the perception or recollection, the volition or thought, and the consciousness. Each of these rises and falls. When you witness risings and fallings, you will realize that they are not permanent. They are transitory. Transitory, yeah. As things rise and fall all the time like this, how can there be a self or a person? So we say, selfless, yeah. Selfless, yeah. Selfless, yeah. This must be uttered from the depth of your heart, not just a lip service. Consequently, your feeling of attachment will gradually fade out. Your attachment will loosen up. You feel loosened up. Loosened, yeah. Loosened, yeah. Loosened quite a lot, yeah. You say whatever you feel, but you should not use too many words. Loosened, yeah. Loosened, yeah. When a certain feeling is loosened to the end, you'll experience liberation. Gone, yeah. Extinct, yeah. When things have fallen from your hand, fallen, yeah. This means you have been thrown away. Pardon. This means they have been thrown away. Thrown away, yeah. Thrown away, yeah. So this is just one lesson, the breathing lesson. We have not come to the other body movements yet. You know what to do with the breathing. Any ordinary person can follow it. If you think there are too many steps, you may leave out some of them. You may do so. Just use your consideration. To sum up, you contemplate the breathing, yeah? Contemplate the breathing in and the breathing out. Contemplate the short and long, yeah? Contemplate the coarse and fine, yeah? Contemplate the body and the mental, yeah? Contemplate the risings and the fallings, yeah? Contemplate the change, yeah? That is, contemplate the state of impermanence and selflessness. All right, fade out of attachment, yeah? The end of attachment, yeah? Attachment thrown away, yeah? Everything connected with the breathing, you must feel everything connected with the breathing. When you are watching your breathing, you see things thoroughly in full realization at the time you are meditating on breathing. In other words, you are analyzing things on the basis of breathing. If you don't remember, you may copy what I said from a friend. For the first step, you are supposed to contemplate the breathing, yeah? Then the breathing in and the breathing out, yeah? Then short and long, yeah? Then coarse and fine, yeah? Then the body and the mental, yeah? The breathing is the body aggregate, yeah? Contemplation of the feeling about the breathing is the mental, yeah? Then contemplate the risings and fallings. Rise, yeah? Fall, yeah? Then you contemplate the changes, the state of impermanence. You contemplate selflessness or anatta. Then you contemplate that now you have loosened up your attachment. Some of your attachments are gone, yeah? Some things you used to take hold of have fallen away. You have thrown them away, yeah? How many steps? Have you counted what you have jotted down? Contemplate breathing. This is one step. Contemplate in and out, another step. Short or long, another step. Coarse or fine, another step. The body or the mental, another step. Rise and fall, another step. Impermanence, yeah, another step. Selfless, yeah, another step. Fading out, yeah, another step. Gone, yeah, another step. Thrown away, yeah, another step. Actually, you don't need this particular step, because when things are gone, you must have eventually laid them down. Now, how many steps? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 steps. You may reduce them to 5 or 6 steps, but the complete system consists of all those 11 steps. Keeping control of the citta is to train oneself in mindfulness. I would like you to try to practice meditation. This is the way to keep yourself constantly trained in mindfulness. In keeping control of the citta, one automatically achieves one-pointedness. This kind of practice in one-pointedness is not meant to lead to absorption, either in the sphere of form or in the formless sphere. No. The point is, mindfulness or contemplation is sufficiently good in itself. This kind of one-pointedness is superb. The Lord Buddha praises that this kind of one-pointedness is indeed superb, because one can make use of it in ordinary life. If, on the contrary, one develops it into the state of absorption, say, in the formless sphere, one won't be able to make use of it. One will remain absorbed with no senses functioning. So one cannot make use of absorption. However, when not in absorption, one can make use of the total mindfulness and one-pointedness. This is comparable to money. If you have money and don't use it, you won't profit from it. If you have money and make full use of it, you will profit from it. Therefore, both mindfulness and one-pointedness that are developed through this practice are very useful. This kind of one-pointedness is called Anantariya Samadhi. It is the samadhi which is the twin of the intellect or insight. We are not directly practicing one-pointedness, but it will eventually develop on its own accord, out of the practice of mindfulness, as mentioned. This means one-pointedness rises and is put to use right away. The engine is not run for nothing. It's like when we drive a car, you see. We start the engine and then we engage the clutch and off we go. If we run the engine for nothing, we are crazy. How can the engine be efficient if it is run without getting the car to move? This must be crazy. So, when you start the engine, you should engage the clutch and then go out to work. This is what is called Anantariya Samadhi, the samadhi which rises and is put to use right away. It is being used to meditate, to contemplate. One might say that this is not so efficient. Never mind. You see, since you are not trained in one-pointedness strenuously enough, you are not going to be an expert. But it doesn't matter, because the degree of one-pointedness at that point is sufficient enough for you to contemplate Dhamma and become enlightened. You just try. You don't have to think about anything beyond what I have explained to you. And one-pointedness will be fully developed, all right. Mindfulness will be fully developed. This is because you have learned to keep watch over a particular sense object incessantly. As a consequence, one secret ability is bound to rise in you. That is, you will certainly not think or speak or do anything before being aware of it. This is very important. From now on, mindfulness will be really swift, just like a flash of lightning. You won't think or speak or do anything without being aware of it. A person who is in the habit of getting himself well aware of thinking, speaking, and doing things will be able to bring about his own salvation. Three meanings in the practice of Ya resonance. Yes, the time is almost run out. I would like to speak next of the meanings of Ya resonance. The Ya of the ignorant. The ignorant repeats the sound Ya because he is told to do so. Of course, he might be serious about it, serious in following the direction. This is the Ya of the ignorant. Many are in this category. It wouldn't have been better not to say it. Some say Ya with such an intensity, for Ya, rise Ya, in Ya, out Ya. If one utters this with all seriousness and attachment, one will not profit anything from it either. This is the Ya of the ignorant. Now, the second Ya is the Ya of mindfulness. It is accompanied by mindfulness. One is mindful at the time one utters in Ya or out Ya. One does not feel tense about it. This is the Ya of mindfulness. One feels it each time one breathes in and each time one breathes out. It's not the Ya of the foolish. Now, the third Ya is the Ya of wisdom. That is, after one has realized the motion of one's breathing, its physical and mental aspects, its risings and fallings and all, one gets the insight that all are simply conditions. They are not a creature or a person who feels or who causes one to feel. This Ya is excellent. It is the Ya of wisdom. This Ya just accompanies and acknowledges a condition, not a person or a self. This is the Ya of wisdom. This Ya is meticulous, refined, wise, and profound. Let's utter the Ya with this insight. Suppose we are being mindful of breathing. Breathing in Ya, breathing out Ya. Now, if one is tense because one is struggling to be good, or prominent, or successful, one will utter the Ya with a serious feeling. Therefore, when one learns to be mindful of the breathing, in Ya, out Ya, in Ya, out Ya, one will simply play with the words and might go out of one's mind because of that. On the contrary, if one is mindful of the breathing in and out, one will say Ya with mindfulness. One will say Ya with all gentleness. Mindfully, one says, breathing in Ya, or breathing out Ya. One knows just that, not more. This is the Ya of mindfulness, which is quite all right too. Now, after you have contemplated to the last step until you realize that there is just the breathing, not a person who is breathing, you will get an insight that you are just breathing in and out in accordance with nature. There is not a person. This Ya is accompanied by wisdom, a very long subject. This Ya is helpful and is full of meanings. Just that Ya, not a person, Ya. This third meaning, the Ya of wisdom, is accompanied by insight to the highest degree. The first Ya is the Ya of the ignorant. One says it because it is fashionable to do so. When one hears other people say Ya, one simply repeats after it. Since one does so with seriousness, it might sound blunt, you see. The second year is the year of mindfulness. One is well aware of a sense object before one utters the year. The third year is the year of enlightenment. One actually is clear as to the nature of selflessness or non-self. A movement rises in accordance with nature, in accordance with the law of cause and effect, ittappajjayata. That's all. This is the wise kind of yaha. There is perfect mindfulness and perfect insight within the sound yaha. To review it once more, the first yaha is the yaha of bluntness. Bluntness. A fashionable yaha, a mere lip service. The second yaha is the yaha of mindfulness. The third yaha is the yaha of perfect wisdom. This is it, the subject of yaha. I have noticed that most people use the yaha very bluntly. In this case, they won't be able to profit anything from it. It is not the right way of using it. It is not in accordance with Dhamma. Get rid of problems as they arise while practicing. Now I will talk about the problems that you need to know. They are the subjects you need to know. A problem may arise while we are contemplating a sense object. For example, as we are contemplating breathing, there might be an intervention of thought. There might be an intervention, a rise of thought. Or we may say that the citta is wandering off. It is attracted to a new sense object. We may also say that there is an intervention of a new sense object. This new sense object might be a thought, a contact of any one of the five senses, an outburst of noise, or a person walking. This might intervene at the time we are practicing meditation. When a new sense object pulls away our attention, we should contemplate it wisely. Then we shall finally come to the point which we shall see no import in it. Thus, we shall give it up. Suppose while we are practicing, we hear an outburst of noise. We should not be frightened. Neither should we lose our balance. Just admit, that's it. Then it will be over and we can turn back to be mindful breathing again. Suppose while we are practicing, we happen to think back of the past, of the one we love or hate. Well, we may follow the thoughts to their thread's end. Then they are finished. Well, how far we can follow? We shall know how things will eventually resolve. We shall also know that this is actually an intervention. As a result, it will disintegrate. Then we shall come back to our practice. We shall pick it up again at the point where we have left. We shall start over again. So, when there is an intervention, whether it be a thought, a person, a thing, an accident, or even an exhaustion, an ache, a pain, we shall deal with it until it is finished. Then, we shall start our practice of mindfulness over again. If there is another problem, any other problem, we shall speak about it later. To sum up, if there are interventions while we are practicing, we shall welcome them. We shall contemplate them thoroughly so that they will eventually dissolve. They cannot last because they are just small, tiny incidents. They will be fading out and gone away in the end. We might waste a little bit of time. After that, we shall come back to the point where we have left off. we shall once more be mindful of the selected sense object in accordance with our principle. Practice meditation at any time. Now, there is another problem, that is the noise. Some ignorant teachers of meditation are unreasonably perturbed by it. So they would take so much of a trouble to chase away the person responsible for the noise. But I would like to tell you that in spite of the noise, you must be able to practice. You must be able to force the citta to contemplate the sense object selected, thus not having to acknowledge other sense objects. Let me give you an example. Suppose you are sitting in a train. Around you are people all cramming up. Under are the iron wheels roaring. Under this condition, you may be practicing meditation, keeping mindful of the breathing in and out. Just try to practice it this way on your way home, whether it be to Phuket or any other places. You may do it on your way from Bangkok to Shaya, however noisy or crammy it may be. If your house is by a rice mill, and the rice mill is working incessantly, you might not hear the sound at all if you are practicing meditation. You might hear only your breathing in and out. Or if your house is by a road on which cars are commuting, you should just let them mind their own business. And you too should mind your own breathing. Or they may be having a celebration of some kind at a temple, of course with a lot of noises going on. But you may be doing meditation just the same. Even if you are right there at a temple, you may do it. You may do meditation even while you are in the middle of a noisome congregation. You must be able to do it even when you are right by a radio or by a musical instrument. You will be able to do it even if you have... You will be able to do it if you have a real intention. Just a real intention to devote yourself to mindfulness. You may do it all right while the radio is on, while the children are at play. You won't take notice of them. You must be able to do it even while it pours down raining and even in ravaging thunderstorms. Don't be such a fool that you can't tolerate a slight crack of noise, that you have to go about telling people to keep quiet or else you would get mad at them and quarrel with them. You know, they might turn around and hit you in the head, and a yogi might be dead simply by being quarrelsome. When I visited King Ashoka's temple in India, I saw several lay yogis meditating by the rocks behind the temple. There were also a lot of people walking with their clothes flitting by the yogis' heads. But those yogis were quite indifferent. It was the place where tourists were coming and going, you see. But the yogis sat meditating since the night time and they felt no disturbance at all. They were not beggars. They did not ask for money. Beggars, you know, were the ones who put pieces of cloth in front of them. But those were real yogis, real ones. And they were also laymen. And they could manage to meditate even among people. At that time I felt ashamed of myself because I used to resent this. I used to resent this and that and could not sit still. Then I saw that those were really tough people who could do it. So you should not resent any noise. Don't be such a fool that you keep thinking of managing the outside without keeping control of the inside. Do something with your inside, and then the outside will be put into order eventually. keep the inside under control. So, if you are by an engine, your house being by a rice mill, you won't hear it. When you sit on a train, close your eyes and meditate all the way. You don't need to let other people know what you are doing. They might think you are sleeping, but it doesn't matter. This means there is no more of a problem, no obstacle. What might disturb cannot disturb. Even if there is a disturbance in the middle of your meditation, your self-control won't be disrupted. You will know what to do with an intervention, so that it will disappear and you will be able to resume your practice. A summary of the principle explained. All that I have explained is the fundamental principle. It is the fundamental you need to know. You may use it everywhere. You may follow this principle and learn to be mindful in accordance with the steps mentioned. You may be mindful of any object you wish. The point is, you should contemplate it so that you know what it is. You should learn to analyze its physical and mental aspects. You should learn to recognize the five aggregates, their risings and fallings, their impermanence and selfless nature. Then you will experience the fading out of attachment until you come to the point that it becomes extinguished. What you need is to see enough of impermanence. Then things will take care of themselves. There will arise a feeling of dispassion, which will end up in the feeling of detachment. This is the so-called shortcut, the shortcut. Even so, we have spent an hour talking together. If we speak shorter, just one word, it will be an extraordinary incident of an extraordinary person. For example, it's told of a certain person who went to pay homage to the Lord Buddha. The Lord Buddha spoke just a few words to the man and he became enlightened. That means the man was ready. He had many things in his heart that were ready. His green and was almost ready to fall. So when he was touched, he fell. He was the type of person who had had a lot of experiences, had passed through a lot of risings and fallings, a lot of loss and gain. He had passed through the state of dualism, so much so that he was ready to fall. So when he was touched a little, he fell. This type of a person did not go through the shortcut, because he was ready to fall already. His way was more than a shortcut. After he had heard the Lord Buddha say a few words, he could become enlightened. This means he was green. He was ready to fall. He was almost ripe. You see, in the shortcut system, we are not going to develop one-pointedness into jhana or absorption. When we have enough one-pointedness, we will contemplate a sense object that we are supposed to. Contemplate breathing, its character, its rising and falling conditions, the state of impermanence and selflessness, plus any of the five aggregates that arises in connection with the breathing. The most important aggregate is the feeling. If you are able to see impermanence in the feeling, you will be safe. This is because everything is merged into the feeling. When one loves, one falls madly in love. When one hates and gets angry, one hates and gets angry madly. So if you see impermanence in the feeling aggregate, selflessness in the feeling aggregate, things are bound to finish. You will be released from attachment just by way of this practice. So this is called a shortcut. The shortcut consists of two or maybe three steps. Develop considerable one-pointedness, contemplate breathing until you see impermanence. Then things will take care of themselves. This is the shortcut. If you don't go through the shortcut and follow the whole system of mindfulness on breathing, you will have to go through the four foundations of mindfulness. There are four steps in each foundation, so there are altogether 16 steps. This is a serious undertaking. Moreover, there are special problems in each step, many. This is the whole complete system. You have to contemplate every phase of the citta. You have to learn to control every phase of the citta. But here we don't have to practice mindfulness of the citta, which constitutes the third foundation. We don't need it. However, those who wish to be a perfect yogi or an Uppatopaka Vimutti Arahant, which means an enlightened one whose vehicle is both jhana and insight, will have to go through all those steps. But a genius or an intellectual who is clever indeed might pick up an easy way and is able to succeed in all those steps, perfectly efficient through all of the four foundations of mindfulness, even in a short period of time. But you see, we are not that kind of person. We are not that clever. We are still creeping awkwardly in the field. We are not able to do all that. So we need to choose the way that is suitable for us. And this is enough for us. Enough. It can protect us from a nervous breakdown. We won't have a breakdown and be ashamed of a cat. We will develop mindfulness and awareness quickly. We won't make errors in our work. We won't love and hate too soon. You see, these defilements are as swift as lightning. If you have not enough mindfulness, you will fall prey to them. Also, if you can't control the citta or the heart, it will follow the dictate of defilements. That is, if mindfulness and wisdom have no control of the citta, defilements then will exercise control and become the citta's property. The citta has two properties, defilement and enlightenment. Whenever enlightenment is in control of the citta, it will pull the citta up above the defilement. The practice we have been talking about is the way to train the citta to move to the side of enlightenment. With enlightenment, we will be equipped with mindfulness, tranquility, and wisdom. Under this condition, there is no such thing as the self. There are just the citta and the property of the citta. You can come to this. You should work up to the realization of truth. Then you will be rid of ignorance. What I have talked about is the ABC of meditation which one needs to know. Otherwise, one will go deeper and deeper in ignorance. One will go deep in ignorance if one doesn't practice meditation. All right, I have thus far talked about or explained the shortcut for Vipassana meditation. I have explained the shortcut system, not the complete formal system. And even for the shortcut system, I have talked only of the first subject, that is mindfulness of breathing. Now, there is still a system concerning the various postures, several topics, but they are not very deep and lengthy. There should be mentioned also hints and techniques for one to exercise control over them. I will speak about them later. Now, the lecture has come to an end. I wish to stop my lecture for today here. I will leave this opportunity to the reverend monks to chant the Dhamma so that it will inspire and strengthen your practice of meditation.